Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. So in this video I'm gonna do step 2 CK questions with you guys for pediatrics. So let's get started. As we are always used to, I'm gonna read the last two lines first. And also another tip I wanna talk about guys is reading the answer choices. This gives you an idea about what topic they're talking about. Is it musculoskeletal? Is it hematology? Is it allergy, immunology, stuff like that? So first I'm gonna read the last two lines. The remainder of the examination shows no abnormalities. Leukocyte count is normal. So I do not highlight anything that's normal. We only highlight the abnormal. Which of the following conditions most likely cause the patient's current symptoms? And what I see in front of me are mostly musculoskeletal. So now I know what the question topic is. So we have a 15-year-old boy is brought to the physician because of left-sided groin pain and difficulty walking. So the first thing I highlight, guys, would be the complaint. And in line with the demographic in a teenager, he reports having pain at rest and increased pain with activity. He recently started playing football but does not recall any trauma, meaning we're excluding trauma here as the cause of his hip pain. He has had many episodes of joint and bone pain that required hospitalization in the past. So past history here is important in chronic diseases. The patient, his family immigrated from India. There is no reason to tell you where he came from unless there is something that there is probably a prevalence of certain diseases in Southeast Asia or certain countries. So he has to mention to clue you into a certain diagnosis. Now all his vitals are normal, so we're excluding here any infectious cause or inflammatory cause, except that he has tenderness on examination. All right, so let's go through the answer choices here, guys. It's not septic arthritis because he's not feverish, right? Plus his total leukocytic count is normal. It's not impaired skeletal growth. Did not mention any of this because he's at 25th percentile for height, which is normal, right? It's not slipped capital femoral epiphysis because he's at 20th percentile for weight, and this is more common in the obese. Obviously not osteomyelitis because we're talking here joint pain and not bone pain. Stress fracture, that's not the case because no trauma, right? Developmental dysplasia of the hip is more in newborns. So we're between transient synovitis and avascular necrosis. Now because of the history, guys, of episodes of joint and bone pain, especially from an immigrant, is most likely talking about sickling crisis of sickle cell disease. And so this person has increased viscosity, which leads to thrombosis of the arteries, and this could be avascular necrosis of the femur. So when blood is sluggish because of sickling, it can obstruct the arteries going to the femoral head. So there is avascular necrosis. Moving on to the next item. All right, here. So the first thing we should do, guys, in a question with labs is highlight the abnormal labs. The abnormal labs I see here in front of me is anemia, low hemoglobin. I can see that it's microcytic, and I can see low ferritin, right? And anti-tissue transglutaminase IgA is positive, and this is the antibody against gliadin, testing for celiac disease. So now we know we're in a case of celiac disease, and I can essentially answer this right now just by choosing a gluten-free diet, for example, without even reading the rest of the vignette. Now what he's asking here is that a biopsy is suggested, but the patient is unwilling, which defines the most appropriate next step in management. So it's all about empirical therapy based on our labs since she refused a biopsy. All the vignette here up there is talking about the complaint, which is typical for celiac disease, diarrhea, bloating, abdominal discomfort, right? Especially that is a Turner syndrome patient, she's highly likely to get autoimmune disease, including celiac, right? So he's only distracting you. He's mentioning the clinical picture of celiac disease and other stuff that are irrelevant. What's relevant about the backpacking trip across Southeast Asia? Nothing, right? So you can figure out the diagnosis simply by reading the labs and the last two lines. Moving on. Here we have a 5-year-old boy. Now let's read the last two lines. There are excoriation marks and crusted lesions. The remainder of the exam shows no abnormalities, which is the most appropriate next step in management. And I can see here drugs related to antibiotics, immunoglobulins, vitamins. So let's see what this patient has. 5-year-old boy, what's the complaint? Generalized pruritic rash for 14 hours. 5 days ago, he had pink eyes that resolved spontaneously. It looks like this is a rash. And previously, 5 days before, it was preceded by conjunctivitis. Now, a very important part of this patient's history is acute lymphoblastic leukemia on chemotherapy, which means this patient is immunocompromised. And so I have to keep this in mind when choosing treatment, right? Now, he's feverish, right? Other vitals are normal, and the skin shows multiple crops, macules, and papules over the face and trunk. This is typical of the chickenpox exanthem. It's papulovesicular. This is one of the few viral exanthemata which are papulovesicular, the rest being maculopapular. Now, what do we do with chickenpox in immunocompromised patients? We have to give them intravenous acyclovir. This is unlike the supportive treatment that we usually do for other children with chickenpox. Here, because this patient is receiving chemotherapy and he has leukemia, we have to give antiviral acyclovir. All right, guys. Now, why not immunoglobulin? Because immunoglobulins only work within 3 days of infection or of exposure, right? And he has had the conjunctivitis 5 days ago. It looks like the illness started much earlier than when the rash appeared, right? Next. Okay, so when asked to stand only on his right leg, the left pelvis sags. The remainder of the exam shows no abnormality, which defines the most likely cause of these findings. Without reading the vignette, guys, I can tell you that he is describing here the Trendelenburg sign. However, I'm gonna keep reading the question. 6-year-old boy has a 3-week history of limping. His immunization is up to date and he received his 5th DTaP vaccine 1 month ago. All vitals are normal. Now, why is he mentioning this? There is no one piece of information that's mentioned without reason. This vaccine, guys, is given intramuscularly. And because he is 6-year-old, because he is over the age of 2, it's okay to give intramuscular vaccines in the gluteal region rather than the thigh as with infants, right? Now, in the gluteal region, there is a very high risk of injuring nerves, right? Now, the Trendelenburg position described here that when he stands on the right leg, the left pelvis sags. What that means, here is the right leg, the gluteus medius and minimus muscles here should abduct the thigh to stabilize it, the iliac crest, at the same level. When this muscle is weak, which is his right leg that he's standing on right now, it cannot push, it cannot abduct and raise like this the iliac crest, so this leg falls, right? So that means that the right leg is affected. Now, what nerve innervates this muscle, the gluteus medius and minimus? It's the superior gluteal nerve. Now, when he stands on the right leg, the left pelvis sags. It's the leg he's standing on that's affected. It cannot pull. And so it has to be the right superior gluteal nerve. All right, guys? So this was a short video about pediatric questions, how to go through the vignettes and narrow down the diagnosis quickly. I hope this video helped. Let me know what you think in the comments. All the best, guys.